I'm Walter Cronkite. What you see behind me is my voice, a picture of it. This is a motion picture soundtrack, and this is the end result of a show business revolution that still ranks as one of the big entertainment stories of the 20th century. Whereas once a scene would have to play like this. The same scene could now play like this.
Take him for a ride.
Today, the story of how all of this happened. The movies learn to talk. Today, a billion-dollar industry began in 1889 as a nickel oddity with the kinetoscope, an invention of Thomas Alva Edison. The solitary viewer can observe silent, moving pictures of subjects like strongman Eugene Sandow in action on film. The film is driven by a small motor between two spools. These pictures last approximately 30 seconds. By the turn of the century, the movies emerge from the peep show cabinet and are projected life-size upon a screen. Living picture showings become common from the arcades of Coney Island to the cafes of Paris. The projection equipment is hastily erected, often shown by the same man who photographed the film. The primitive projector is cranked by hand. Audiences gape in wonderment at silent, moving images. A speeding locomotive seemingly approaching them at full speed is an awesome sight, while the used image falls harmlessly into a convenient receptacle. By 1902, the first theaters exclusively for movies are open. The screen is still silent. Within 10 years, they become a thriving business. Screen personalities like comedian John Bunny emerge, known only by their faces, appearing in dozens of short films a year. As movies mature, musical accompaniment enhances screen action. Movies learn to tell a story, though the plots are simple, naive affairs. They acquire a language of their own, a pictorial language. If the idea cannot be presented pictorially, titles make it painfully clear. A small orchestra replaces the piano player, but the quality of the films has not improved. Capable actors like H.B. Walthall, the black-hearted villain, and Blanche Sweet, about to be saved by Harry Carey from a fate worse than the plot itself, must resort to exaggerated gestures and stilted posturings to express themselves wordlessly. There's not only music in the orchestra pit, but on the set. Silent screen stars demand musicians during shooting to put them in the proper emotional mood. Eventually, story techniques become more refined, films more sophisticated in content. In the 20s, the movies are a visual art. The mobile camera makes any effect possible. It glides, swoops, swirls, and swings from overhead, catching dazzling images to show up on the screen. But for years, a new dimension has been restricted to the laboratories, sound. In 1877, Thomas Alva Edison develops the phonograph recording. He combines the phonograph with his kinetoscope. Now, in his words, all motion and sound can be recorded and reproduced simultaneously. His kinetophone appears in 1895. It fails commercially. However, many Europeans freely employ Edison's combination of phonograph and projection and display movies accompanied by random musical selections. Just music and pictures with no attempt to synchronize. But an advancement is made in the first groping attempts to give the screen a voice. November 17, 1902. Léon Gaumont presents synchronized sound movies in Paris. One film shows the famous actor Coquelin in the duo scene from his stage success, Cyrano de Bergerac. There is always the danger that an absent-minded operator will put on the wrong record with disastrous results. Since the language barrier presents difficulties in the world markets, the only sounds in many early efforts are universal ones. Laughter, music, sound effects. One of the main drawbacks in early sound movies is the lack of amplification. Primitive speaker horns make the recordings audible only within range of the machine. For large audiences, it is impractical. Undaunted by the previous failure of kinetophone, Edison revives it in 1913 using elaborate synchronization methods and larger speakers. Some of his films include spoken dialogue, but most depend upon musical selections such as arias from La Bohème. Kinetophone still sounds muffled and unreal. Edison discontinues kinetophone films. The three-element vacuum or audion tube, invented by Dr. Lee DeForest, brings increased amplification and greater clarity. The Bell Telephone Laboratories obtain the rights for its use and experiment with an improved sound-on-disc method. None of the movie companies show interest, except Warner Brothers. In an agreement with the Bell Laboratories and Western Electric, they label the amplified phonograph and projector system Vitaphone. August 6, 1926. The first Vitaphone program is presented in New York. A series of musical preludes followed by a feature film. The feature film, Don Juan, starring John Barrymore, does not use dialogue, only synchronized sound effects and a musical score played by the New York Philharmonic. This night, the movies take a momentous leap into the future. The premiere of the Vitaphone sound on disc system meets with favorable reaction, although there are some skeptics who uphold the cause of the silent film. And there have been previous experiments in reproducing sound. Sound variations change to light variations, enable a soundtrack to be combined on the same moving strip of film to the left of the picture image. This assures synchronization and eliminates the cumbersome disc. It is the method used today. A leading pioneer in this field is the inventor of the Audion tube, Lee DeForest, although he profits little from the venture. His phonofilm process is shown in 1923. The entertainment values are considerably behind the technology. Former DeForest associate, Theodore W. Case, also experiments with sound on film at the Fox New York studios, assisted by E.I. Sponable. In this early test, the imperfect recording speed gives Case's voice a high pitch.
The camera's about up to speed now. We're taking this at about 80 feet a minute. Here's the test word that I want to try. Tease crisp. Tease crisp. All right, E.I., you can shut the thing off now. Yeah, shut it off. E.I., will you please shut the camera off?
I'll try blowing a little, see how that sounds, shall I? All right.
Later at corrected speed, camera and sound running at 90 feet a minute.
How's that? Can you feel the air? I'd like to know whether you can feel the air coming to you. You people that are sitting there watching this picture. Kush, can you feel it? Can you, E.I.? I see. Now, the amplification on this number 5 microphone is, gee whittakers, those lights are awfully bright, E.I.
June 1926. Case tests a vaudeville act.
I got no more wind.
Movie mogul William Fox to Case. I'll spend $1 million if you can get the thing to work out of doors. He does. The result? Greater immediacy is brought to the newsreel by sound on film. The new system called Movie Tone allows Bernard Shaw to speak to the world.
Oh, Liz. Well, this is a surprise. Have you all come to see me, ladies and gentlemen? Well, I should never have expected this. It's not necessary for me always to look as genial as I'm trying to look now. Of course, I can put on the other thing, for instance.
A new era in motion pictures is about to begin. For the first time, natural sound, dialogue, and singing will be used in a feature film, The Jazz Singer, to star Al Jolson. George Jessel, who played the role on the stage, is at first offered the part, turns it down, gives Jolson his opportunity to make film history. Jack L. Warner, president of Warner Brothers, tells of those days.
In the 1920s, silent motion pictures were strongly established as popular entertainment. They had come a long way from the novelty of one and two reel film to feature-length productions which told sustained stories. There was a general belief at that time that motion pictures had progressed as far as they could go as a medium of dramatic expression and satisfying entertainment. My brothers and I believed otherwise. We were determined to break the barrier of silence and bring full life to the screen by giving it a voice that would be heard around the world. To this goal, we dedicated the full resources of Warner Brothers. This was an all-out effort with the future of our company at stake and possibly with the destiny of the motion pictures in the balance. There were setbacks and discouragements and a great deal of criticism from doubters who were annoyed with us for not letting well enough alone. Many said in public statements that talking pictures were a novelty and wouldn't last 30 days. But then on the night of October 6, 1927, came the full realization of everything we had set out to do. With the New York premiere of The Jazz Singer and speaking from the screen, Al Jolson uttered the never-to-be-forgotten line, "You ain't heard nothing yet." Warner Brothers had given the screen its voice, and a vast new horizon for motion pictures was really opened.
Baby, I'm coming! Oh, God, I hope I'm not late! Baby, don't you know me? It's your little baby! I'd walk a million miles for one of your smiles, but my
The rush begins. As more and more theaters become wired for sound, stage-trained actors, directors, and writers flock to Hollywood. Although The Jazz Singer contains only 291 spoken words and is at first not accepted by the trade press, the public at large has taken the new talking phenomenon to its heart. Frantically, producers struggle to finish silent films still in production before it is too late. The onrush of sound creates technical problems. Hand-cranked cameras have to be replaced by motor-driven ones for uniform speed. High-amp lighting gives off a crackling sound that will be picked up by the sensitive microphone. One of the last great non-talking films, the Fox production of Sunrise, ingeniously compensates for the absence of the spoken word by use of musical effects. Once the free-roaming master of the screen, the camera is now back to its primitive, immobile state. Only now it is enclosed in a soundproofed sweatbox to muffle the noise made by the camera motor. Cameramen are literally parboiled. Actors are forced to stay close to the single microphone. The sound man is king, the cameraman and performers his slaves. 1928, the first all-talkie, Warner's Lights of New York. Primitive today, with the microphone concealed in the telephone.
I planted the stuff in Eddie's shop.
Yeah?
And the Dicks will be there at 10 o'clock.
Uh-huh.
But they must not find Eddie. Don't you understand?
What you mean?
Take him for a ride.
1929, Foxes in old Arizona with Warner Baxter. The microphone is hidden here in this first outdoor all-talkie. The disc method has lost. Sound...
My audio. Tell him you're this Cisco kid.
Today, the movies can reproduce any sound. Movie studios maintain vast libraries of sound effects of every conceivable description.
It's sunset, getting away in front. Bandstand is running second.
A scene no longer has to be recorded on the spot. For the following scene, each sound has been recorded and prepared separately. At the recording session called the final mix, these separate sounds are combined and properly blended. The finished result is what the movie audience will see and hear.
Second by high ahead. Nevada's running third by 3/4 of a length. Short notice fourth. Lady
Come on, Charmboy.
Relax,
Chummy.
Charmboy is making his move on the inside. Here comes Charmboy running over horses. Charmboy is winging on the rail.
As sound techniques improve, the screen is flooded with a series of gay, gaudy, sometimes grotesque musicals. The Broadway melodies, the big broadcasts, the gold diggers. The musical is a new form of entertainment for the screen. It was on October 6, 1927, that Al Jolson uttered his famous prophecy.
Wait a minute. Wait a minute. You ain't heard nothing yet. Wait a minute, I tell you. You ain't heard nothing.
But even Jolson could not foresee the tremendous impact made by this added dimension, the screen actor's voice. Formerly, actors' faces were their fortunes. With sound, not only their faces, but their voices.
Right, as soon as I've gone, you count to 20 slowly and then scream your head off.
I will.
All right, start counting.
You know you don't have to act with me, Steve. You don't have to say anything and you don't have to do anything. Oh, maybe just whistle. You know how to whistle, don't you, Steve? You just put your lips together and blow.
You're good. You're awful good. I'd walk home if it wasn't for all that water.
I touch nothing stronger than buttermilk. 90 proof buttermilk.
Sam, you can dish it out, but you're getting so you can't take it no more. If anybody turns yellow and squeals, my gun's gonna speak its piece. Yeah.
I'd just begun to think I was wrong about you, but I wasn't. You haven't a human bone in your body. There's not a drop of blood in your veins. You're nothing but a...
Ladies and gentlemen, my mother thanks you. My father thanks you. My sister thanks you. And I thank you.
Step outside and make those cracks.
I'll make them in Macy's window. You're a small timer and you'll never get any bigger. You were born and raised in Hester Street. Mark my words, that's where you're gonna
you
stay.
You shut up!
Oh, my darling, my sweet, my beautiful, my poor.
And don't forget, come up and see me sometime.
Marie, I pledged myself to find a cure. I can't stop now.
Daddy, I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid of being left in mourning, Lauren. I'm not afraid. Why should I be afraid? I'm not afraid.
The movies had learned to talk, sometimes falteringly, sometimes well. With sound, they would play out their turbulent history on the screen, on television, before the eyes of the world.
I'll never get over that. 3,000 miles, 3 years, and all of a sudden you...
I had it all planned that way.
In the sound man's classic phrase, the movies were okay for sound.